Hello, and welcome to worship for First Christian Church of Cuyahoga Falls. We're so glad that you are joining us today in this unusual reality that we share. I invite you, if you have not already, to take a moment and prepare this space for your time of reflection on God's word and on the Spirit in our midst. That may mean lighting a candle. It may mean taking some deep breaths. We also encourage you to gather some elements for communion, as that is something we celebrate every week. Every time the word is shared, we have the opportunity to respond to the word. One of the ways that we do that is through joining in that fellowship of communion. It doesn't have to be with bread and juice, but whatever you have on hand. Jesus chose the most common elements of what was found on that table, which he shared with friends on his final night. And so whatever you have in your home will be blessed as well. Today, we reflect on the events of this past week and the speaking of God's still small voice throughout the ages. Our lectionary passage for today is unusually, well, perhaps not so unusually timely. And so I invite you to be in a spirit of prayerfulness and listening, watchfulness with me during this time so that we may move into a space of spirit-filled action in the days to come. Will you join me in a call to worship? There is silence and there is light. There is music and there is grace. There are people and there is life. There is hope and there is God. Let us worship well today. Let us pray. God of grace and God of chaos, we have indeed experienced both this past week. And so we ask that you would help us to more palpably feel your presence, to understand that gift. We ask that you will weave among us and help us to feel connected, help us to find your truth in the midst of all the competing voices in our hearts and minds, in our ears and in our bones. We ask that you will renew us and inspire us to be more faithfully your church, living and breathing a faithfulness of Jesus Christ into the world. Help us to live a resurrection faith that brings healing and hope and unbounded love set loose in the world that challenges the powers which would oppress, the powers which would repress, the powers which cannot understand the strength and the potency of your power and love and grace, because it is so counter to what we have become accustomed to. May we be willing to cross over into that space that we may receive more fully the gift of your wisdom through your Spirit. Amen.
Stars of
Greatest gifts we share as a community of faith is the opportunity to be in prayer with and for one another. And so whenever we gather together, however we gather together, we make sure to take advantage of that opportunity by sharing our joys and our concerns and our prayer updates. Because we are using this online format, we've been more cautious about exactly what details we share in our public services, but we are receiving prayer requests and updates throughout the week. You can send those either directly to myself, Pastor Debbie, or to our administrator, Sarah. And you can do that by contacting directly fallsfcc@gmail.com or through Facebook or calling the church, calling my personal number. Know that we are here for you. And the world continues to change. And in so many ways, it does not, for better and for worse. And so we continue to hold on to those gifts of good things that we would like to carry forward with us. And prayer is one of those good gifts. If you would like to receive the prayer updates as they come out each week in our email, you can also make that request through the same contact. Because there are folks who are praying with and for us each and every day. And we are in need of that power in our lives. So please don't hesitate to make that connection and receive from these opportunities for us to be in ministry with and for one another. One of the other ways that we connect and share our gifts is through our financial offerings, and I continue to be so profoundly grateful for the faithfulness and the spirit of generosity from this congregation, from friends and members and our virtual visitors who continue to share your tithes and offerings to keep our ministry moving forward, that we can provide space for community groups, that we can provide meals for families in need. We've started providing books as well, combining our pantry with a little library, and We are hoping to come up with some other fun fellowship opportunities as the seasons change, and we know that expectations are going to look different for schools and families. We want there to be opportunities for you to find reprieve and joy in your time together, and for us to continue to experience those opportunities with you as well. So please be watching for that in your emails and hopefully in coming announcements here as part of worship. For example, next week, Kenyana Sunny Matthews is going to be sharing the word with us. And I am always profoundly grateful for her voice. She has published an article just today about the tragedies, the murders, the attacks that have happened in the last few days, and we will talk a little bit about that during the sermon. So if that is not a conversation that you are ready for, this may be something you need to come back to. But it is a conversation that we need to have, because it's happening all around us, with or without our participation. And our role as the church is to be the voice of faith within that conversation, to be bringing the good news, the gospel. That's what gospel means, is good news. And that doesn't always look like what we think it will. So please know that there'll be more opportunities coming up for us to engage in intentional conversation and reflection, so that we may go forth in thoughtful action and moving collectively as the body of Christ in the world. With that in mind, let us turn to our scripture selection for today, which comes from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. This is a continuation of the story of Moses. Last week, we heard the birth narrative of Moses and reflected a little bit on the role of community in that story. Because so often we simply compare it to the story of Jesus's birth, where in both instances there was an order for genocide set forth by the king or the pharaoh, depending on the circumstances in the story. And we focus on those individual characters. But last week we really took the time to examine the role of community in participating in our own salvation and taking responsibility for our brother or our sister or our sibling in humanity, and what that looks like and what it means for us. So now we come back to Moses in his story before he has become a savior for his people, but is living off of the land and has experienced an exile of sorts. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses," he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings. And I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. But Moses said to God, if I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this my title for all generations. There are several things that stand out to me in this story and our experiences of this past week. As I shared last week, my struggle was coming up with what to say when we have felt so stuck. And I started to reflect on passages in scripture where our ancestors of faith have experienced similar frustrations or concerns. And I thought of the story of Moses when God speaks to him and calls him forth by name to be an ambassador and an advocate for his people. And Moses says, who am I to do this? I'm not a good speaker. I don't know what to say. And so we discuss that sometimes it's not about knowing what to say. It's about doing what is right. Here, we are reminded of the many times in which God shows up in extraordinary ways in ordinary places. I'm struck by the fact that we imagine Moses wandering the hillside quietly at night with the sheep as he shepherds his way through the dark. And in that stillness, there is this burning bush. It doesn't say there was a thunderclap or a lightning strike or anything terribly astonishing, but the mere presence of God was what was bewildering. And yet God doesn't express a sense of silence. God says, I have heard my people. So I started to imagine what this scene was like from the perspective of the Holy, from the Holy One hearing the crying out of the people over and over and over again, the way that we should be hearing the cries of our kin as they are suffering oppression and racism and profiling and attack. This week has been filled with juxtapositions that make me deeply uncomfortable. From forest fires raging to hurricanes and floods, from Black men being shot in the back in front of their children, to white boys walking past police, to murder fellow human beings. These are not easy things to discuss and acknowledge. They are things that we cannot look away from. Just as Moses could not look away from the burning bush. This week in Cuyahoga Falls, we saw our own pillar of fire as the river caught fire once more. And instead of folks having an initial reaction of empathy and grief for the family who lost a loved one, there were jokes being made. Have we been isolated so long as to be so insensitive? Or is this the way it's always been? That we have this desire to cover up the flame of God, to snuff out the voices crying out from God's people for the sake of our own comfort. The juxtaposition of this passage being the predestined, pre-assigned scripture reading for this week, and the events that we have seen or avoided in the news has me wrestling with how often and how quickly we would throw shade over the light as it is revealing difficult truths to us. That we would besmirch the character of a victim so that we don't have to see them in their full humanity. Is this not what the Pharaoh and the taskmasters did to the Israelites? Is this not what we have done in our own history as a country, saying that all men are created equal and in the same breath, practically, then qualifying that Black men only count as 3/5 of a person? We can't continue to try and smother the truth. We can't continue to try and justify wrongdoing by covering fire with dirt. I think that we do this out of our discomfort, out of a sense of disempowerment. You know, Moses said to God, "Here I am," but he also said, "Who am I? Who am I to be the one to save these people?" And yet, how much power did he have? And what a unique position to bridge peoples together. We so often ourselves do not acknowledge the positions of power and privilege that we find ourselves in. Particularly as a white woman, I have experienced sexism, and yes, even in the church. And yet, we white women are in one of the most significant positions of power because of our proximity to white men in positions of power, our opportunity to influence, and the level of empathy and sympathy which we receive. Over the last few weeks, as we studied the book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree by James Cone, we reviewed the story of Emmett Till, who was murdered on the word of a white woman who found his comments, his glances too suggestive. He was just a child. And on her deathbed, she recanted. But it was too late for Emmett Till. And it has been too late for too many, for too long. We cannot afford to look away. It is costing lives every day. Not just the ones we hear about in the news. And this is not in any way an attack on any particular occupation or political party. It is simply a reality check for the reality in which we are living. Some of us more fully than others, because not everyone can escape. Not everyone is safe. And yet we are reminded, who did Christ come to save, if not every single one of us? And so God clarified, in a time of crisis, as God so often does, I am who I am. Sometimes translated, I am that I am. Because God is active, was and is and will be active in the world. Is our faith active? Are we awake? Are we looking? Are we paying attention? Are we listening? Are we saying, here am I. I will protect your people. I will walk with your people. I will guide your people. Moses was instructed to remove his sandals because he stood on holy ground. And it was a sacred moment. I invite us to remember that these are sacred lives which have been lost. What if everywhere is holy ground? If every life is holy, isn't this what the gospel is all about? Thy will be done, thy kingdom come, that this would be our reality? For to be on earth as it is in heaven, I cannot fathom that this is what it's like in heaven. And yet, Jesus gave up so much to come and live and walk among us, despite all our flaws, all the dangers. For him to walk the face of this earth as an educated, provocative, vocal Black man who challenged systemic powers of oppression. And for that, he died. For us, he died. For all future generations, he died so that no one else would die. So why are we still killing each other? As surely as Judas participated in the execution of Jesus, our complicity to systemic racism means that we have participated in the execution of these men and women and children. And so, though we grieve for that loss, we also must do better. We must seek reconciliation, and that can only begin by facing the truth. And so God's light reveals, and we sit at the foot of the cross, we sit by the burning bush, we sit and we stand in protest with our friends and our neighbors and our colleagues and our co-workers and our family. And we fight for the liberation that is the story of our faith. It is the foundation of what God has done and continues to do for us. So I invite you this week, if you haven't already, to review what's been going on in the world while we've been shut away in our homes and busy with our own lives, that we might be more grateful for each breath we have. And the fact that there is no one with their knee upon our necks, keeping us from breathing, keeping us from standing, keeping us from experiencing the fullness of this life. I know that for some of you, this message may feel like a bit much, but I assure you, it is nothing compared to what Black and Indigenous peoples and persons of color have been experiencing this week, previous weeks, months, years, decades. You cannot smother the truth, because the power of God's light is too strong. It overcomes all darkness, and God's people will continue to cry out and thank God that God continues to listen. I pray that we may have the courage, compassion, and the fortitude to listen to. Because as Jesus explained to his disciples in their final meal together, there is work to do. He was explaining the time of turmoil and transition that they would be facing as his own crossroads came to a head. So while they were eating, he took bread. He blessed it. He broke it, and he offered it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, and he offered it to them, explaining that it was the cup of the new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sins. And he said, "Drink all of it. For as often as you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's life and death until he comes again. For surely I will not eat of this bread or drink of this cup until I share it again with you in my Father's kingdom." Friends, we have kingdom and kingdom building work to do. So let us receive these gifts that we may be prepared to participate as partners in Christ's service, and that we may be reminded that whatever we may face, God goes with us, God goes before us, God hears our cries, and we'll find a way.
For hope and some peace of mind.
But there's a friend
who after all the wrong you've done, but oh,
you'll take the pain away.
I dare you get down on your knees,
you'll take the pain away,
and begin to pray to the Father,
ooh,
and say, Lord, incline thine ears to me,
ooh,
oh, and he will hear you, oh, yes, he will. Hear you plead. Hear him in your broken heart.
You'll take the pain away.
Just have faith and believe.
Difficult times, difficult conversations, difficult realities to face. But together and through the gift of God's presence, there is nothing we cannot do. So go forth with God's liberating grace, with God's unbounded love, and with a ferocity of faith. It gives us the courage to truly walk in the footsteps of Christ, wherever that may take us. Be blessed.